Hello, everyone. Welcome to the State of the Industry episode of Almond Center. As you probably know, Almond Center is the national hit broadcast about everything almond. And today we will be talking about everything that happened this year. For those of you who are still coming in, come on in. We got about 15 minutes till we start shooting this show live. You will be part of it. We will have applause signs. We're going to ask you to applaud, but you're going to want to anyway. So if you've had no people that are out there that want to, that are waiting to come to this broadcast of the State of the Industry, let them know, text them, tell them to come on in, because we will be starting soon. We know that it's a lot going on today, a lot going on downstairs, and that people are around trying to still gather themselves and getting ready here. So if you got friends out there, tell them to come on in. We will be starting in about 15 minutes, and you're going to love it. By the way, I am your stage manager, so if something goes wrong, don't blame me.
My Almonds represents Yara's commitment to helping growers produce their best possible crop in terms of both yield and quality. Our knowledge, digital tools, and comprehensive crop nutrition portfolio help California nut growers increase their profitability while reducing the environmental impact. Yara, knowledge grows.
Finally, this is the site all the world was waiting for, the Almond Conference back live in person, and we're all together here in Sacramento.
That's right, Brian. Our show is coming to you live from Sacramento's Safe Credit Union. And already, we've set a record for attendance in this newly renovated building.
Almond Center has all the information, all the events, all the speakers, and all the entertainment you've come to expect from the Almond Conference.
And Sacramento restaurants and bars are waiting for you outside. You'll hear all about that and lots more.
I'm Brian Wahlbrink.
I'm Richard Waycott. Almond Center starts now.
Our top story, the long-hoped-for return of the Almond Conference to downtown Sacramento is underway. After a temporary move to Cal Expo in 2019 during the renovation of this beautiful facility, then being forced to go virtual last year by the pandemic, the 49th annual Almond Conference is finally back home. This conference is the almond industry's premier event. It's how growers, handlers, and everyone in the industry connects and learns how to make life better by what we grow and how we grow. The Almond Conference draws attendees and exhibitors from around the globe and is one of Sacramento's largest business gatherings.
In fact, this is the first major business event held in Sacramento's Safe Credit Union Convention Center. And the word on the street is that Sacramento is thrilled to have us back. Our senior Almond Conference correspondent, Rick Cushman, is out on 13th Street with more.
Brian and Richard, I am outside the main entrance, and you can feel the excitement out here about having the Almond Conference back in town. And leading the cheers is Visit Sacramento President and CEO Mike Testa. I caught up with Mike right here earlier today, and I asked if this was the biggest thing ever to happen to Sacramento.
Rick, we're thrilled to have the Almond Conference return to Sacramento. We know it's obviously important for the almond industry, and for Sacramento, it signals a return to business as usual, well, except for the mass part. Is it the biggest thing ever? Well, we have the Kings and the Golden One Center and a backlog of concerts there. We've got the Junior Olympics next year at Sac State. We've got NCAA basketball returning. We've got Broadway shows like Hamilton. We've got the Farm to Fork Festival, the Tower Bridge Dinner, Aftershock, which is the largest hard rock festival in the nation, the World's Strongest Man competition, Michelin-rated restaurants. But yeah, the Almond Board of California is right up near the top.
I also asked Mike why the Almond Conference and Sacramento are such a good fit.
Well, as America's farm to fork capital in the middle of the largest almond growing region in the world, this really is an ideal partnership. And we're excited to welcome the attendees and organizers back to our city and to this incredible new building. You know, the ethos of Sacramento is about food and agriculture, and the confines of the conference really align well with that. So we're fortunate to have them here, not only because we align so well, but also because it's a December piece of business, traditionally a hard time to get conventions in cities. So we're grateful for the partnership.
Now, Brian and Richard, this is a big deal for downtown Sacramento. The conference is expecting 4,000 plus participants. And as you said earlier, this is the first large business event for Sacramento Safe Credit Union Convention Center, which is open again after its two-year, $350 million renovation and expansion. I caught up with the busy conference organizer, Rebecca Bailey, and I asked her what is on tap for this week.
The Almond Conference 2021 kicks off with the State of the Industry and Almond Center, and immediately following State of the Industry is a welcome reception on the trade show floor, which will be a great time to visit with more than 260 exhibitors and catch up with industry members. We are ending the opening reception a little earlier today to allow people to go out for dinner with their customers and colleagues. It's been 2 years since we've been together in person, and we know people are eager to see each other.
Now, my sources are telling me Wednesday and Thursday are packed with breakout sessions and some outstanding speakers at the keynote lunch events.
That's all true. Wednesday and Thursday breakout sessions will be on topics with everything from global market development to mating disruption. And Wednesday's lunch, sponsored by Yosemite Farm Credit, will feature a dynamic presentation from Barbara Stuckey from Madsen, which is North America's most successful independent developer of food and beverages for the retail food and chain restaurant industries. Then, for Thursday's lunch, sponsored by Farm Credit, we have an international businessman who traveled all the way here straight from his home country to share his story. Dan Ohn is a former Vietnam refugee who immigrated to Canada after the Vietnam War and built a global nut empire. And then finally, I'm personally most excited for Thursday evening's gala dinner, where we will enjoy a private concert from rising country music star Tyler Rich. Tyler grew up in Yuba City, so not too far from here, and graduated from Sacramento State, so he may be a familiar face for some of our attendees. We are excited to celebrate the evening together as we close out the conference.
I'm told people should check in at the registration desk for the availability of tickets to those very major events. This will be an action-packed 3 days here in downtown Sacramento. For Almond Center, I'm Rick Cushman.
It's been a big year for the California almond industry. The 2021 crop year records, and so many shipment numbers hit new records. I'm here at the Big Board with our senior shipment correspondent, Bryce Spicer, also known as Big Bryce, who's going to explain it all.
Yeah, why don't we look at some big numbers while we're here at the Big Board. Let's start first with production. You can see I've got the last 10 years graphed here, 2 billion pounds in the 11-12 year. How about 3.1 billion pounds in the 2020-21 year? So big kudos to everyone in the almond industry for making that happen. It's a landmark record.
So Bryce, when you look at this graph, it sort of ends at the right-hand side. What's going to happen on that side in the future?
Yeah, so here we go. Increase-wise, I mean, again, just to underscore this, 37% increase over the last 2 years, and everything on this chart you see that's in green is a record-breaking. So it's almost like for 5 years running now, record, six of the last 10. And as we look at what's been happening over the last 5 years, 10.4% compound annual growth rate over since 2015-16. So to your point, Richard, where are we going in the future? Well, if we want to know where we're going in the future, sometimes it's helpful to look back where we've been in the past. Here's a graph of the last 30 years for production. Those that can remember, in the 2002-03 year, we crested that 1 billion pound number, big landmark year. And then my first year at the Almond Board, 11-12, 9 years ago, 2 billion pounds. And then, of course, this last year, 3 billion pounds. So, you know, if the Almond Board was formed in 1950, 50 plus years to get to the first billion, 9 years to get to the second, another 9 years to get to the third, I don't know. Who knows what the next 9 years hold?
Well, Bryce, coincidentally, as you said, I arrived at the Almond Board right here.
Oh, there you go.
You arrived at the Almond Board right here.
Yeah.
And we're both still here.
Yeah, there you go. How about that?
So congratulations.
Yeah. But you know what's also interesting is to look at shipments. So we've talked about growth of the production, but how about shipments? So if you look at the top here, 2002-03, that first billion pound year, Western Europe made up over half of our shipments where they were going around the world. Asia Pacific, 26%. You fast forward to that 2 billion pound crop in 11-12, that pie starts to get split up a little more. Look at Middle East going from 9% to 17, and then you see Western Europe going from 56 to 35, but Asia Pacific coming up to 38 being the largest destination. And that still holds true to last year as well. You can see the pie chart from 10 years ago to this last year, very similar, albeit another billion pound shipped over that period of time.
So I think it's just fascinating. When you look at 20 years ago and how different the world looked in terms of almond shipments geographically, and then by 2010, 11, 12, we were at this point, and we're still at that point, and we'd grown by a billion pounds. So that means that we've had sort of universal growth in all these regions so that these percentages stay the same.
Absolutely. It's all about finding the right mix, right? It looks like maybe we found the right mix here.
And that's very healthy.
Yeah.
Because we're quite evenly distributed around many parts of the world, not too overly dependent on our dear European friends, some of whom are here today.
Yep. And then lastly, let's look at just record shipments again. 2020-21 was a record shipment year, just under 3 billion pounds shipped, 2.9. You can see here steady growth on the domestic side, strong growth on the export side, and I'll have more numbers to share with you later, but really just a record-breaking year in so many ways in 2020-21.
Bryce is the numbers guy at the Almond Board of California, and he will be back with more figures, I can guarantee you. Thanks, Bryce.
Yep.
Those shipment numbers are very impressive considering the port and shipping issues that range from container shortages to major delays. It's been amazing to see the perseverance throughout the industry, but there are still significant issues to be dealt with. The logjam at our ports continues. For the latest details, senior port correspondent Jeffrey Bogart is at the Port of Oakland with a report.
The global supply chain is broken and is in need of repair. Logistical bottlenecks continue to have a major impact on almond shipments. The COVID-induced increase in manufactured good imports from China has led to severe port congestion, empty container exports, canceled bookings and sailings, excessive carrier fees, and warehouses being pushed to their limits. Ocean shipping and ground transportation costs are increasing, and there are not enough truckers to move cargo. Almond shippers have been stressed to their wits' end, engaged in a constant game of logistical whack-a-mole as they face daily cancellations or last-minute changes in shipping schedules that call for immediate pivots. An AVC handler survey revealed that it is not uncommon for consignments to be delayed several weeks in getting to overseas buyers. In an effort to quickly deliver imports from China to the lucrative Southern California market, ocean carriers have been reducing service or even bypassing the Port of Oakland. This is a serious trend, given that approximately 85% of California almond exports typically ship from right here from the Port of Oakland. Therefore, there is an urgent need to get ocean carriers back to Oakland servicing our top markets. The industry has asked, is there a light at the end of the tunnel? Well, efforts are underway on several fronts to try and address the issue. Unfortunately, there are many components to these export delays, so solutions must be multifaceted. For now, our handlers must continue to seek creative solutions for shipping almonds, given that the export delays we are experiencing are expected well into 2022. ABC will continue to provide industry updates as we have been doing. And as always, we encourage folks to contact us with data from the trenches or any short-term best practices for coping with them. Brian and Richard, these problems are not going away anytime soon. From the Port of Oakland, this is Jeffrey Bogart for Almond Center.
Thank you, Jeffrey. We appreciate that report, and we'll stay tuned for latest developments. In other national news, former Almond Alliance President Elaine Trevino was nominated in September by President Joe Biden to be the country's chief agricultural negotiator for the U.S. Trade Representatives. Round of applause. While Trevino awaits confirmation, the Almond Alliance Board of Directors has named Aubrey Betancourt as its new president and CEO. Our senior ag trade and frozen tundra correspondent, Keith Schnellner, is live from Fargo, North Dakota to tell us more about trade.
Hey, Richard, Brian. Weather's not bad here in frosty North Dakota for December. It's only 37 below zero or something like that. Some people say I'm nuts. Speaking of nuts, trade for almonds is critical. Last year, California exported 72% of our production, But when most Americans talk about agricultural exports, they think about soybean or corn exports from places like this in the Midwest. But exports are fundamental to the success of our almond industry. When markets like China suddenly require new facility registration requirements, or India imposes retaliatory tariffs, our industry needs quick action and solid relationships. I just caught up with Julie Adams on some of these issues. She's ABC's Vice President of Global Trade and Regulatory Affairs. Her team works on issues like this every day.
With record export shipments to more than 100 countries last year, we really have to be prepared to help almond shippers and customers navigate everything from retaliatory tariffs to an increasingly disrupted supply chain. That means we have to rely on good relationships and close collaboration with trade and government partners so we can monitor everything that may be from EU's Green Deal and farm-to-fork strategy or labeling requirements in India. This means we have to have fact-based information and data that we can share with them. The other critical part of our success is having strong relations and collaboration with trade negotiators in DC who understand the needs and priorities of crops like almonds. That's where the nomination of Elaine Trevino to be the chief ag negotiator in the U.S. Trade Representative's office is really great news for specialty crops. Now, we're going to look forward to working with Elaine in this new role, but we also are really focusing on our continued successful partnership with the Almond Alliance and their new leadership. Together, we have to deal with a lot of issues that are going to impact almond production and shipment. So we have to be ready to be in lockstep, understanding what's going on, and finding a way to ensure that almonds are going to be moving around the world to customers, supporting our communities in a way that really keeps us moving into the future.
From Fargo, North Dakota, I'm for the Almond Center. I'm Keith Schneller.
Whoa. Thanks, Keith. Appreciate the report. Good luck out there. That looked cold. New Almond Alliance President and CEO Aubrey Betancourt served as Director for Sustainability for the California Cattle Council and Western United Dairies and has years of experience dealing with California ag and natural resource issues.
So I'd just like to add my thanks to Elaine for 3 great years of collaboration and getting so much done for the California almond industry through advocacy and her work there. And a hearty welcome to Aubrey. We really look forward to partnering with you. And whoever thought we'd have an employee in Fargo, North Dakota, for crying out loud.
Who knows?
Anyway, the ABC Board of Directors has welcomed several new members since we last met. We've had a couple of recent elections and have quite a new team on board. And to get up and close, to get up close and personal with them, we'd like to turn now to Board Vice Chair and Senior Board of Directors Correspondent George Gashgarian, Jr. He recently spoke with each of them for a report we're calling 3 Minutes with George Jr. Here's George with Paul Ewing.
Paul, nice to see you today.
Good to see you, George.
You know, I've really enjoyed getting to know you last couple months at the Almond Board of California, and I was hoping we could have a little conversation today. So people in our industry can get to know you as well as I have.
You bet. Look forward to it.
You know, how did you get started in the industry?
So my mom's cousin, Ned Ryan, was part of ARPAC. He gave me projects throughout college that were related to almonds when I was studying at Cal Poly. And then he gave me an internship after college. That was kind of my introduction to the almond business. And then through a friend I was working with in the almond business, Garrett Doropal, I got into the farming side of things.
That's very interesting. Very interesting. What does it mean to you to sit on the board?
So it's an important commitment, you know, being there to represent the growers. And I really enjoy hearing from growers and getting their feedback and bringing that to the board and working with all of you to help shape the future.
Yeah, those are all great points. We've got a rather difficult couple months ahead of us. What are you most looking forward to, and how we're going to deal with what we're going through right now in the industry?
Well, I think we've got we're really heading in the right direction with kind of reshaping our sustainability programs and focusing on carbon. I think there's tremendous opportunity there, and I think our domestic marketing program, we have some really exciting things on the horizon there. So I think it's all looking really positive and good important few months ahead here.
Yeah, it's going to be some heavy lifting, but I'm really looking forward to working with you and the rest of the board to address these issues. Along those same lines, what do you appreciate and respect not only about the almond industry, but also serving on the board?
I appreciate, you know, the high professionalism of the staff. They just do a phenomenal job of putting everything together. And the colleagues, you know, it's a real diverse group of board members, you know, makes it very, very exciting. You get to learn a lot and get different perspectives.
Yeah, I agree with you. I'm always amazed what I can learn by sitting down and talking with anyone I can in the industry.
Yes.
And just closing up, at the end of the day, you get done with a hard day's work. How do you most enjoy to have an almond?
Favorite options, my great-grandma's recipe is blanched slivered almonds that you put in the oven with butter and salt and kind of a medium roast. Those are really good. Almond butter, plain almonds, you name it.
Yeah, I agree with you. Haven't had a bad one yet.
Yeah.
All right, thanks a lot, Paul.
Thank you.
I appreciate your time.
Thank you.
Thanks, George. Thanks, Paul. Great interview there. We'll have more of George's special report, market updates, and plenty more excitement right after this break. Don't go anywhere.
According to the Chinese proverb, a journey of 1,000 miles begins with a single step.
I grew up right here, North Modesto, on my grandfather's farm. I felt the responsibility to help my family find a solution for ag burning.
The Almond Board of California is proud to bring you the story of Brent Holtz, a researcher who began the first whole orchard recycling trial in his backyard 40 years ago to find a sustainable alternative to open or cogeneration burning.
I wanted to put out a small-scale scientific study that I could show that a whole orchard could be recycled. And I think my grandfather would be very proud that an alternative to open field burning actually came from his family farm and from his grandson.
Coming soon to almonds.com.
So thank you, Brent, for many years of service to this industry and really uncovering some great opportunities for us. We have more record shipments to talk about, and Big Bryce is back at the big board. So, Bryce, what do you have for us this time on the North American market?
Well, surprise, surprise, I got some more big numbers for you. So let's look at the North American shipments. I've graphed here North America, obviously Canada, Mexico, domestic. Domestic, obviously, our largest destination, over 800 million pounds shipped in the 2021 year. But no slouch here, Canada and Mexico also good for another, but about 100 million pounds. And we see big growth in Mexico, 25% year-over-year increase there, and steady growth on the domestic side as well. And what I find really interesting is if you look a little deeper and you look at, by product type, look at here, I've plotted shelled domestic shipments since 2015 and also manufactured. So manufactured would be mechanically altered almonds, so sliced, diced, blanched, that kind of stuff. Look at that trend line of the manufactured. And I think that's really encouraging to see because that's more of that being done at our handler processors rather than farther down the value chain. So it's more capturing there.
And you think about food innovation and product innovation and those ingredients that we're producing now, that some of which we weren't producing years ago, and that's all going into to new almond products that are appearing just about in every aisle of the grocery store today. Fantastic trend line there.
Yeah, it's just more of the awesome story about almonds that we can tell. So I'll be back in a little bit. I'll have some more numbers for you, and thanks so much.
Thank you, Bryce.
This just in, we have breaking news from Los Angeles. Our North American marketing team there caught up with the almond advertising team shooting an ad right now for a new campaign and a new almond hero. We're proud to give you the national introduction of, drumroll please, thank you, Al the Almond. Al is all about health and energy, and he will be talking right to millennials, an important and growing audience for almonds, and a group looking for these qualities. North American marketing and celebrity spokesperson, correspondent Becky Jeffers, is live in LA with more.
I'm so excited to be here in LA at Scarborough Park filming our latest consumer advertising for the US. We're gonna have lots in store for you, so let's take it away to Jen Freeman to give us a little bit more details. Jen?
Hi everyone, we're so excited about our new marketing campaign for the United States. It's super important for us to get millennials to snack on more almonds. And this campaign is all about almonds being millennials' friend and wellness and how we can help them achieve their goals. Now I'm gonna turn it over to Jen Sterling from our advertising agency to tell you more.
Hi, I'm Jen with Sterling Rice Group. We're here at the shoot and we're excited to share with you on Wednesday a little bit of what's going on. We are doing a lot about...
Like what are you shooting?
I think about friends with wellness.
Friends with wellness? I'm wellness! Did you know that almonds are a wellness snack? I am a wellness snack and I will see you tomorrow at the conference.
Yeah,
bye!
Thank you, everyone. That's all from us at the advertising shoot. Back to you at the Almond Center. I'm Becky Jeffers.
This is just what the world needs now, an almond hero. And that guy has more energy than Brian. Well, we have our own legends to talk about today. Legendary heroes here at Almond Center. And that includes George Gosh Garing Jr., who is back with another installment of 3 Minutes with George Jr. He's talking with new board member, Christine Gemperly.
Hey, Christine, how you doing?
Hey, George.
How was your crop this year?
It was rough.
Yeah,
us too. I had a rough year.
Yeah.
We had a crop.
At least you had something.
Yeah.
Well, you know, getting down to brass tacks, how'd you get started in the industry? What's your genesis?
Well, I was born into the industry. My dad farmed almonds my entire life. And of course, when I left high school, I left the nest and I went off for 8 years, but eventually that farm drew me back and I came back to the Turlock area and my brother and I started our own almond operation.
Along those same lines, what does it mean for you to serve on the board?
I feel really honored to be in the almond industry at this time. I mean, I feel a big responsibility here because we're guiding the industry through pretty tough times. It's a lot of responsibility, and I don't take it lightly at all.
What are you most looking forward to in the next couple of years as we traverse our way through this?
Our ability to change how we are viewed. I mean, I think it's amazing the way our industry, especially with the help of the Almond Board, we can pivot to meet all these changes that we are going to be experiencing. I want to inform the world that almond farmers are definitely the climate change heroes and that the almond farmers are leading the way.
That is absolutely fantastic. I love that. Along those same lines again, what do you most appreciate about our industry and also serving on the board?
What I appreciate most about our industry is our absolute commitment to the land, to preserving the land and to the communities that live around them. The research that ABC does with the growers' money. I mean, we have seen research, groundbreaking research in skin health that's been brought to us by the Nutritional Research Committee. I mean, and look at the research that went into whole orchard recycling that is really changing how we do things on the farm at the end of our orchard's life. And it also is bringing this into this whole this space where we're being seen as real climate heroes. I mean, this is where it's happening because we're sequestering so much carbon and creating so much soil health. And this really can be attributed to the research that was funded by the Almond Board. And I'm really, really proud of it because it's giving us more more tools in our toolbox, you know, and that's what we need.
Yep. Closing up, what is your favorite way to enjoy California almonds?
Well, it used to be cookies because I make a lot of cookies, but I have discovered something new. So you take a dried apricot, and that's a plug for Westside Growers, and you put a scoop of almond butter on it, and then you drizzle it with chocolate ganache and maybe throw actually some cocoa nibs or some just crushed almonds on it. It is pure California.
That sounds fantastic. Thanks so much for your time, Christine.
Thanks, George.
Wow, that Christine, she's like a box of chocolates. You never know what you're gonna get.
Nuts or chews. Anyhow, thank you, Christine, and please, at the next opportunity, next board meeting, please bring that chocolate extravagant dessert that you just mentioned. That'd be great to try. So Brian, you know, these have been strange times, COVID, masks, all the stuff we've been living through, right? But since we've been co-anchoring Almond Center, the most popular television show in the Central Valley, California, I've noticed you a little more closer up, you know, and there's no mask on, and I've been meaning to mention something to you.
Uh-oh.
Don't worry, this is a compliment, but your skin just seems to glow, and I don't notice a wrinkle anywhere.
Well, there's a reason, Richard. I eat a lot of almonds.
Well, that explains a lot. In fact, a new study funded by the Almond Board of California's Nutrition Research Committee shows how almonds can prevent wrinkles. Senior almond nutrition beauty and skin health correspondent Swati Kalgankar is live just down the street in Sacramento with all the details.
I'm in Sacramento at the cutting-edge facilities of Zen Dermatology. I'll be meeting with the director of clinical research here, Dr. Raja Sivamani. He's also a board-certified dermatologist and an adjunct associate professor in clinical dermatology with University of California, Davis. Dr. Sivamani, the ABC Nutrition Research Committee funded you back in 2015 to conduct a pilot skin health study investigating the health benefits of almond consumption on skin wrinkles. Could you please walk us through the design of that pilot study and of the larger study that followed?
Absolutely, Swati. First, let me start by commending the Almond Board for funding this study. It's the first time that we've had a whole food study looking at skin health, and the first time it's ever been published in a peer-reviewed journal. So for that, major kudos. And this study was designed by recruiting postmenopausal women, and we split them into two groups. One group got almonds as a supplement, and then the other group got a control diet that wasn't almonds. And we asked a simple question. Can we have them supplement with this over time? In the pilot study, it was over 16 weeks. And in the full-blown study, it was over 24 weeks, so it was 6 months. And the question was, did the wrinkles change or not? And how we did it was we used these high-resolution cameras that are so good at picking up every single micro feature on the face that we could really bring a lot of objectivity. And it really truly was food science means technological advances.
So it sounds like a lot of effort and cutting-edge technology went into making the study a reality. What did the studies demonstrate?
The studies demonstrated some very exciting results. In both of the studies, including the pilot study and the follow-up study, what we found was that the women that supplemented with almonds had an improvement in their wrinkles, whereas those women that didn't eat any of the almonds or didn't get the nuts as part of their supplementation didn't have any improvement. Not only that, in fact, in the follow-up study, we also looked at the skin tone and how even it was, and not only did their wrinkles improve, but their skin tone started to become more even as well. So very exciting results.
Absolutely. So now what would you tell our almond growers about the potential of almonds, the potential that they hold in the area of skin health?
Well, I think the future is delicious with almonds, but all of you already knew this. But what I think is really exciting is that it's not just about almond consumption, because now we're looking at almond oil and how that may impact the skin. We're doing two studies looking at how it might even skin tone and how it might affect wrinkles. But not only that, we're also looking at how it might affect the gut health, and the, what we call the gut microbiome, which is that community of bacteria and fungi that are living inside of you that are a vital part of our health. And we're also going to be looking at other endpoints now, other conditions like acne. So we're really expanding to bigger populations, much beyond just the women that we initially studied. And we're hoping that we can really define health in many different populations going forward.
Thank you, Dr. Sivamani. To hear more about these and other studies about almonds and skin health, join us in Ballroom B10 tomorrow to get the skinny on ABC Skin Health Research. Dr. Sivamani will be presenting alongside Dr. Zhaoping Li from University of California, Los Angeles. Details are in the Almond Conference program. From Sacramento, for the Almond Center, I'm Swati Kalgaonkar.
Brian, this is such fascinating stuff. I mean, who thought 10, 15 years ago we'd be talking about wrinkles and beauty and dermatology? And it's just, this industry just keeps going in new directions and keeps finding new reasons to eat almonds. They're good for you. They make you healthy. They make you smarter. And they make people like you look better, even. So we have a health halo that's there, and now we're adding on to this beauty halo, and I think it's just fantastic. One more reason to add almonds to your daily diet.
Absolutely, Richard. Health and nutrition are also great sales tools. As the ABC global marketing team knows, and there's no better place where the connection between almonds and beauty is more important than the Asian markets. For more about a big year in Asia, we go to Causeway Bay in Hong Kong, and our senior China correspondent, Connie Chung.
Thank you, Brian. As you can see, this is rather late in the evening in Hong Kong, and I'm at the heart of Causeway Bay, the hub of beauty. There are cosmetic shops and skincare shops everywhere, including the flagship stores and international brands and the small local niche brands, and they are still open. Beauty is a passion out here, and recently, the China team has taken the skin research insights and expressed them in a series of creative and engaging programs. A team of Chinese skin professionals was formed, including dermatologists, cosmetic formulator, and a nutritionist to redefine the standards of beautiful skin. They are advocating healthy skin is beautiful skin and breaking a lot of skincare myths. They live stream talk show programs and short videos to reach their target audience. People could also upload a no-makeup photo of themselves along with their real age onto an innovative skin test app that tells you your skin age right away. This lets the user know if she has been taking good care of her skin. In a country where women see being beautiful has a lot of privileges, almond definitely brings them hope and new news. That's it from Hong Kong, the city that never sleeps in the search of beauty. For Almond Center, I'm Connie Chang. Now here's my colleague, senior South Korea and Japan correspondent, Muriel Kim.
Connie, Hong Kong looks very warm compared to where I am. I'm on Gangnam Street. This is the street for beauty. This area is filled with beauty shops, cosmetic stores, aesthetic clinics, and jewelry shops. Almonds are popular and continue to be valuable in the beauty market here. We not only distribute the study results to newspaper media, but we also collaborate with the top K-beauty YouTubers to make our own almond beauty videos to maximize the beauty research outreach. And we have a new almond brand movie that we can use for our beauty advertising. From Gangnam Street, Seoul, South Korea, for Almond Center, this is Muriel Kim.
I know Brian was paying a lot of attention to that beauty information.
Absolutely.
More on that later. We'll be right back after this commercial break when Brian may learn even more about staying beautiful. Stay with us.
An adhesa tu día con almendras. Vamos, sonríe que el día es largo. Almendras, ricas en proteína y te dan energía para lo que sigue. ¿De aquí a dónde? Ponte almendra.
Genieße Mandeln. Deinen natürlichen Beauty Booster voller Leben und Energie. Mit Nährstoffen, die deine Schönheit zum Strahlen bringen. snack designer.
We are back, and we have more from Senior Board of Directors correspondent George Gashgarian Jr.'s special report talking with new board members. It's 3 minutes, give or take, with George Jr., and now he's with Darren Rigg.
Hey, Darren, how you doing today?
Doing pretty good.
How are things running up at your operation?
Running pretty smoothly, all things considered, I guess. Not getting those containers out, but other than that, you know, full steam ahead.
Sounds good. That sounds good. What's your background in the industry? How'd you get started?
I started working for a processor up north after I graduated Chico State, working in the processing facility in about 2008, and got involved at the Almond Board in 2009 through their inaugural leadership program. So I was one of the first batch. And from there on, just springboarded through the industry. I got some networking connections through there. My father works in the industry, so here I am today.
All right. What does it mean for you to sit on the board?
Well, it means a lot. It means, I guess, there's some people that care about what I think or have to say about it, and it maybe even agree with me. So I don't mind being that voice and, you know, making bacon up there in Modesto.
Well, in that same vein, what are you most looking forward to moving forward this next couple of years? We got a lot of issues ahead of us.
We do. And I know your dad was part of the nutrition research, and I look forward to increased investment there and more information to be gathered so we can leverage that more globally with the information we've been able to get on that regarding diabetes, you know, just the healthy lifestyle that a lot of the world is trying to aim for, especially during COVID. Your lifestyle choices really become life-saving choices. So, you know, I think we need to hammer that home, baby.
What do you most respect and appreciate about the almond industry?
I love that it's so fragmented. I really do. I know that that's not what a lot of people might say, but I like it because there's a lot of voices. There's more than one way to skin a cat. You know, you can have a lot of different business models and still be successful, whether that's on the growing field or the processing side. So there's so many different ways that we can work together and be successful in this industry. We all don't have to fit in one box.
I'm gonna ask that same question again, but I'm gonna twist it a little bit. What do you most respect or appreciate about the Almond Board of California?
Well, I think that we're considered, you know, the pinnacle when it comes to marketing boards. Yeah. You know, talk to any other industry throughout the United States, hell, even globally, like on the INC. And really, everybody's jealous of what the Almond Board has been able to do. And we're used as a model, you know, whether that's the pecans, whether it's Turkish hazelnuts, of what they want to become. So I think we need to continue that. I think a lot of the board people right now, the people involved volunteering in the committees, we're continuing that because it's a lot of work to sustain. It's hard to keep everybody together. But that togetherness ultimately is what's benefited the whole industry as well as our marketing board.
Yep. Now, just finishing up on a more lighter note, what's your favorite way to enjoy California almonds?
I'm simple. I like them roasted, salted, sea salt and vinegar with artificial flavoring, with a nice ice cold beer. You know, I love marketing the healthy stuff, but for me, I just want something that tastes good, good for my soul. So slam dunk on that.
Yeah, you got that. Thanks, Darren. I appreciate your time.
All right. Thank you.
Thanks, George. Thanks, Darren. And Darren, let's go ahead and get that beer after this is all done. What do you say?
You think we should launch a new brand called Slam Dunk?
I think so.
Okay. On that one.
We've been telling you about growth in records throughout the show, and there's been no market that has had more growth than India. Senior India market and exciting growth correspondent Sudarshan Mazumdar is live from Green Park in New Delhi with all the details.
Yes, Brian, I'm at Green Park, New Delhi. India's had a season to remember. In a year filled with challenges like no other, almonds has come out to be a winner. To understand why the almond market is growing so rapidly, we're going to talk to a couple of customers outside a big store. I have with me Aarti, who's going to tell us why she buys almonds. Aarti, can you tell our viewers as to why you buy almonds?
Almonds have always been a part of my life. When I was a child, my mother soaked them in water overnight. Next morning, she would peel and keep them for me to munch on as she braided my hair before school. She always used to say, for a good memory and success, have them first thing every morning. And then when I became a mother, I continued this tradition by giving them to my child. Now even my husband joins me in mourning by having almonds every morning.
Thank you, Aarti. As you can see, we have a home ground advantage of the long-standing tradition of almond consumption running through centuries. Our program is leveraging this tradition to grow the market. But as the market has been growing, there have been other forms of consumption which have been building up. To help us understand these new forms of consumption, I have with me Chetan, who is an investment banker and a fitness enthusiast. Chetan, can you tell me, why do you have almonds?
So I actually developed this habit during the pandemic, when the pandemic hit. And without any medicine or vaccination in place, the only bet we had was our own immunity. And almonds are known to be a top immunity booster. So I started consuming almonds not with my meals, but between my meals as a snack. Now it's come to a point where I keep a stock at home and in office to regularly snack in between meals. So, you know, like, in all honesty, my job requires me to take a lot of risks. But you can't take the same kind of risks with your immunity and your health. And in that scenario, an investment into almonds is the safest bet.
As you can see, the marketing program in India is working very strongly. Consumers are understanding that almonds are good for health and they're good for providing immunity. The market size of India is large, but the future is bright. From Green Park, Delhi, for Almond Center, this is Sudarshan Mazumdar signing off.
Thank you so much, Sudarshan, and sorry you couldn't be with us here this year, but we look forward to seeing you soon. And now, back to the big board with Big Bryce. We're going to talk about our largest export market, India, which has just been on a tear. Yeah. What do you have for us?
Wow, incredible, exceptional, explosive. You run out of superlatives quick with India. Let's look at just since 2015-16, almost tripled the amount of shipments in that short period of time to India. In 2018-19, India became the largest export destination, and it followed up that performance by, in 1920, just 11% year-over-year gain. And then this last year, the gain from 1920 to 2021, 42% increase year-over-year, which is just unheard of. So really, the growth story there is just wild. It's great.
And with over a billion people, again, I'm going to ask you the same question. You know, that chart ends with a big column on the right, but we can't see how, where it goes. So, you know, what's your thoughts about future of Indian consumption and shipments?
You know, my future vision's a little blurry, Richard, but if we look here just as far as India, 2015-16, India made up 7% of our total shipments that went out. Again, and then now we come to 2020-21, 12.5% of total shipments for the whole industry went to India. And if you look, India's population's a little over 17% of the world's population. So who knows? Maybe there is still a lot of room for growth there. It's really an exceptional market.
I'm sure Sudarshan will make it happen.
Yeah.
Thanks a lot, Bryce.
Yeah, and by the way, Brian, your skin does glow quite a bit. You know, wow.
Thanks, Bryce.
No wrinkles.
That was really nice. Really appreciate that, Bryce. Thank you. Market growth was everywhere this year, and that includes our friends across the pond in Europe. For more on the UK and the EU, we take you live to a sofa in London and our European morning show desk with senior morning show correspondents Dariella Rothrocken and Kath Martino.
Thank you, Brian. What a year it's been for California almonds in Europe. Despite the pandemic, our marketing hasn't missed a beat.
There are so many best bits, but for me, one standout is that our newest market, Italy, became the ABC market with the highest per capita consumption of California almonds. We also breathed new life into our German campaign and started leaning into beauty as a new focus. And I'm so excited to be kicking off 2022 with a brand new advertising campaign in France. And we can't forget that Europe continues to influence food manufacturing, and it's hard not to be excited by some pretty big launches like the vegan take on the British classic Dairy Milk, now featuring almonds.
Another significant milestone this year was the launch of the European Reputation Management Program, We've started making inroads this year, proactively communicating this industry's sustainability story. Our Do You Almond campaign in the UK is another one of our highlights. One of our proudest moments is when our influencer agency told us that Do You Almond over-delivered more than any other campaign they've run.
That is really impressive. From our European morning show desk and a sofa in London, I'm Dariella Rafe-Rackhind.
And I'm Kath Martino. Back to you, Brian and Richard.
Thanks to you, Kath and Dariella. Great job. And, you know, I didn't know about the per capita consumption in Italy is the highest in the world.
Amazing. Wow. Amazing.
Better go on a visit there soon. We're back.
We're back.
Bryce, is it December? Is it almost Christmas? I see something in your hand there. So, talking about Europe, man, sometimes we think that market's just going to be sort of dozing along, but a lot of growth this year. What happened?
Yeah, absolutely. Big shipping months to Europe in 2020, 21. You can see 23% year-over-year increase, which is a great thing to see in that part of the world. If we look at the top four EU markets, all four of which are the top 10 for us destinations, you see really strong performances across the board, double-digit increases year-over-year. But I'd like to look at Germany here. In 1819 to 1920 and 2021, we see steady increases there. And really, there's a lot of good stories to tell all across. You just heard about Italy and per capita consumption. They're, of course, a top four market in the EU. Really just strong stories to tell across that whole region.
I think what we're talking about with the U.S. market and how the growth of ingredients and manufacturing here in California has gone up so much. You know, when we thought about Germany for years, it was like, how are we going to make this market grow? It's a bunch of people eating marzipan all the time. Who wants to eat that stuff anymore? And yet, I think all these new ingredients, this new product innovation, all the health story, now the beauty story, is really pushing consumers in Europe to think very differently about our product.
Yeah, absolutely. It's an important market for us, as is the whole region. So, you know, I was going to stick around for a little bit and help you guys with some math and calculations, but, you know, my 4-year-old daughter's got a Christmas show tonight, and so I'm going to have to run.
Well, thank you, Bryce. We'll miss you. I don't know if we'll be able to talk about numbers anymore. Thank you, Bryce.
I hope he makes it.
I do, too.
So, Richard, I think I know another reason why things went so well in the UK.
And that would be?
People there do indeed almond. As you can see in these messages, we'll be right back.
Do you almond?
I do, little squirrel.
Providing natural protein and nutrients to help fuel your day. Do you almond?
Do you almond?
Providing natural protein and nutrients to help fuel your day. Do you almond?
Do you almond?
Providing natural protein and nutrients to help fuel your day. Do you almond?
Only in the UK. Only in the UK. You little squirrel, you. So, as we told you, Senior Board of Directors correspondent George Gorskarian Jr. has been a busy man. Here is roughly 3 minutes with George Jr., this time featuring new board member Joe Gardner.
Hey, Joe, how are you doing today?
Good, George.
How's the crop look?
It's on the ground right now.
Yep. What's your beginning in industry? How'd you get started in the almond industry?
I guess say I was born into it. I come from a third generation family farm. My grandfather started farming in the Central Valley just after World War II. Came home from the Navy. And we started planted our first almond trees in the early 80s. I came into the family farm in 2014 after I finished up grad school, and I've been slicing and dicing and selling almonds ever since.
What does it mean to you personally to sit on the board of the Almond Board of California?
Well, first of all, it's an honor. I think, to call others on the Almond Board, my peers, is quite an honor. There's some wonderful people in this industry. And having the opportunity to maybe make a small amount of impact that can hopefully positively benefit our industry for years to come.
Along that same line, what do you most appreciate about our industry specifically?
Well, I think everyone can agree it feels good to be growing something that's healthy, that's good for you. You're seeing almonds on every shelf of the grocery aisle, from pharmaceutical to dairy. It's a staple ingredient now. I think as an industry, we should be proud of that.
Yeah, to expand on that, what do you appreciate about the Almond Board of California assisting in that endeavor?
I think the Almond Board is obviously taking the approach of, backing things up with research, which took time. We had to put those blocks together before we could build into an industry that we are today. And, I'm proud to be, proud to have a professional organization, backing up the industry with facts, with research, with dedication. I mean, there's smart, good-hearted, hardworking people. So I think that anything good takes time, and we need dedicated individuals to put in the work, put in the effort.
Well, I couldn't agree more, Joe. Just finishing up today, on a lighter note, what's your favorite way to enjoy California almonds?
I don't think it gets any better than an almond flour chocolate chip cookie and some almond milk. So
that sounds pretty good. All right, man. Thanks for your time. I really appreciate it, Joe. Have a good one.
Thank you.
Thanks, Joe. Thanks, George. One of the serious issues the industry deals with almost every year is the availability of water. This year was particularly hard. The industry faced drought, curtailments, Sigma, and climate change. Our senior water correspondent, Jesse Roseman, is live at San Luis Reservoir to tell us more about where we stand.
Brian, as you can see behind me, San Luis Reservoir is very low. It's a stark reminder of the many water supply challenges facing California. San Luis is way below average due to California being in the midst of yet another multi-year drought. We've seen some rain this year, but we'll need a lot more to get back to normal. Critically important now is how we can secure water to not only refill San Luis, largely through more reliable delta diversions, but also for recharging the critically overdrafted aquifers of the San Joaquin Valley. Without new surface water supply solutions, there are estimates that up to 1 million acres, or 1 out of every 5 acres in the San Joaquin Valley, could come out of irrigated agriculture production by 2040. The Sacramento Valley isn't spared either, as their Sustainable Groundwater Management Act plans, or SGMA, are due this January, and they have their own issues around diverting surface water. On the optimistic side, there is some state and federal funding for new storage above and below ground and improved conveyance, such as fixing subsidence. There's also $50 million in funding for what's called multi-benefit land repurposing for lands that will come out of production due to SGMA. While we need nature to provide more rain and funding in place to store more water and convey it to places that are overdrafted, we also need to navigate the regulations in place that can limit diversions for agriculture. Some call this a double whammy. On top of our Mediterranean climatic drought, we also have regulatory demands that may require keeping more water in streams as part of unimpaired flow discussions, or restrict diversions out of the Delta in accordance with Endangered Species Act requirements. Arguably, our biggest opportunity to improve water supply reliability is improving capture of so-called atmospheric rivers that provide our rain in large torrential events. If not captured in reservoirs or underground, the water largely flows out to the ocean. Thankfully, the Almond Board has tested one method for capturing these flows, through taking excess water, applying it to working orchards during the dormant season, and letting it sink in to build up aquifers and underground storage, also addressing the requirements of SGMA. This on-farm recharge is just one method covered in a new guide to groundwater recharge that has been prepared by the Almond Board. I'm told it's being released there at conference, so now hopefully we will be able to direct flows to overdrafted aquifers and let growers finally improve their own situation. Live from San Luis Reservoir for Almond Center, I'm Jesse Roseman.
Thank you, Jesse. You do such a tremendous job of keeping us up to date on SGMA developments and sort of everything water up and down the valley. So we will marshal through this one way or another. Here's something that's been getting buzz since October. ABC and the Almond Growers of California received a special international award given only in years when a group does exceptional work protecting pollinators. For more, we turn to senior pollinator pest management and award correspondent Drew Walter, who is live in an orchard with Chief Scientific Officer Josette Lewis.
Earlier this year, the North American Pollinator Protection Campaign gave its Business for Bees Sustainability Award to the ABC and California growers for what they said was going above and beyond to support pollinators. This was only the second time they felt someone was deserving, and I asked ABC's Josette Lewis for more details.
Whether it's water or bees, we all know that sometimes it's hard to get the accurate story out, and this award is a great recognition that almond growers are farming responsibly and doing their part for pollinators. It's really exciting to recognize the adoption of the honeybee best management practices that you all do in your orchards every year, keeping those honeybees safe. But it goes on to recognize the investment that you make through the Almond Board in research to advance honeybee health. And lastly, the award recognizes the leadership of the almond industry in stepping forward to co-found the California Pollinator Coalition. It's through this coalition that we were able to bring together the majority of agricultural organizations representing most of the farmed and ranched land here in California. And together working with reputable conservation organizations, working together to identify opportunities to expand pollinator habitat and forage in and around working lands. And in so doing, to really show that California agriculture can be part of the solution to vibrant biodiversity and healthy ecosystems.
As Dr. Lewis mentioned, the formation of the California Pollinator Coalition was a big part in this award. The coalition is made up of many entities, including the nonprofit Pollinator Partnership. I caught up with the director of programs, Lori Adams, to talk about the goals of the newly formed group.
This is an ag-led coalition. So the goal is to scale collaborations between agriculture and conservation for the benefit of biodiversity and food production. So the result's going to be on the ground improvements, technical guidance, funded research, documentation of relevant case studies, tracked progress toward increasing healthier pollinator habitats. And as we achieve this goal, it's going to be laden with benefits for growers and for the environment in California. And those benefits can include increasing biodiversity, sequestering more carbon in the soil, healthier soils, multiple benefits for everyone by getting together and working across all of the agriculture, ranching and farming, and orchards.
Now Dr. Lewis and Adams both said there is still much work to be done. This is a story we will continue to monitor closely. Live in an orchard, I'm Drew Walter.
That's great news, guys. What an honor that highlights our long-standing commitment to bees. We'll be right back from Almond Center in a moment, but first, these messages.
Have you tuned in to the new Almond Journey podcast? Brought to you by the Almond Board of California, this show explores how growers, handlers, and other stakeholders are making things work in their operations to drive the almond industry forward.
I learned that there were other growers that were actually doing a better job than I was, getting more production per acre.
Join me, Tim Hammerich, as I have real conversations with growers and industry leaders all over the valley about relevant topics to the almond industry.
So it's not something that people want to talk about. And when there's no conversation,
there's no clarity. You know, people aren't solving problems.
In our first several episodes that are already released, we've covered topics ranging from water to technology to equipment to sustainability and beyond.
Water use efficiency is going to become and is the forefront of our concern and our need for innovation.
I think hearing the voices of these industry leaders will spark connections and ideas for you that you can use in your own journey.
At 63 years old, I'm not planning to replant this thing again. I want to see what I can do to make this orchard outlive me.
I hope you'll join us by subscribing to the Almond Journey podcast on any of the podcast platforms, such as Apple Podcasts or Spotify or any of the others that are out there, or find the episodes on the almonds.com website so we can all share in the Almond Journey together.
These podcasts are just fantastic. If you haven't availed yourselves of them, I really encourage you to. That's a great use of your time. I know, Brian, you love these things because he drives all over the place. And you can make better use of your time learning something as you go from orchard to orchard. So be sure you tune into those. Back to our man, George Goshgarian Jr., our Senior Board of Directors correspondent, who is back with our final interview, three-ish minutes, with George Jr., this time with Bob Silvera.
Morning, Bob. How are you doing today?
Good morning, George. I am excellent. Thank you.
Good. You are relatively new to the board, and I'm really excited to get to know you. What does it mean for you to sit on the Almond Board of California?
Well, it's a tremendous honor, first of all, to be elected to such a level of responsibility. You know, I've been participating in the Almond Board in different ways for 11 years, but I've been going to almond conferences around the almond industry for about 21, 22 years. And I've always admired the Almond Board a great deal. I remember seeing some of the people that had, that were in leadership positions in the Almond Board over those years. And it's really quite an honor to be elected to participate in that and to try to contribute.
We're really looking forward to your input and your insight. Bob, with 20 years in the industry, you've seen a lot change and you've seen the industry grow. What are you most looking forward to this next few years while serving on the board?
You know, the almond industry has an incredible true story about who we are. You know, we are stewards of the land. We grow an agricultural forest. Apparently, the data is that we are carbon positive. We capture carbon and release oxygen into the atmosphere, all of those things. So we have an amazing story that is one of high integrity, and it's noble, honestly. You walk in an almond orchard, which everyone in this audience it's my favorite thing to do in the world, is to walk in an almond orchard, and you're walking in a productive forest. And so we've got to communicate that. And I think that when we look forward, there's going to be some real challenges with the Almond Board, with what its responsibilities are, because budgets are going to rise. I think they're going to be flat and start to decrease. So the Almond Board is needs to continue to do more with less in promoting the consumption of almonds and in defending our position as a good and noble and honorable crop, agricultural crop.
I got another question here would be, I'm going to phrase this question two ways. What do you most respect about the almond industry? And tying into that, what do you most respect and appreciate about the Almond Board of California? You can answer that as one question, however you want to address it.
Well, I think the thing I enjoy most about the almond industry and the Almond Board is certainly the in the leadership position on that is the people, without any doubt. What a wonderful, wonderful community, a community of bright, intelligent, ambitious people, people of high integrity, and stewards of the land. We all love our almond trees and what we produce. And so that's just amazing. I just really enjoy that in such a great deal. Specifically, You know, I really see the Almond Board and the rest of the almond industry as well, growers, everybody. I mean, it's all really, it's one. I see a real willingness to tackle challenges, to not bury their heads in the sand when challenges are coming, but to confront them, to talk about them. Differences of opinion, come to a consensus, and then set up a plan. I think the Almond Board does a wonderful job with this, to seek out their board and their growers' opinions about a certain topic, seek out consensus as best as possible, and then to come up with a plan and work and execute it as best as they can.
Yep, yep. Well, Bob, thanks for your time today. And closing up, I just got one kind of lighthearted question. What's your favorite way to enjoy California almonds?
Boy, good question. My favorite way, that's a hard question because I enjoy them in so many different ways. But, you know, I think my favorite way is at harvest in the almond orchard. I think at harvest, walking in that almond orchard in the windrow, the almonds have dried up just a bit, but they still have a touch of moisture to them. And I just absolutely love almonds that way. Secondly, I'm going to sneak a second way in, and that is a chocolate enrobed roasted almond is just absolutely is my favorite as well. And I enjoy them both ways.
Sounds good. Thanks for your time this morning, Bob. Have a good one.
Thank you, George. I appreciate it. Thank you.
Thanks, George and Bob. And I agree, Bob. A fresh almond right from the tree is a true delicacy.
What's wrong with the chocolate?
Well, I like them right off the tree.
Enrobed,
I'm a grower.
Enrobed
that was a great
the chocolate.
One. Okay, both. We'll go both. One more record that was set this year was the record for CASP self-assessments, which doubled in 2021. For this, we turn to our senior CASP and assessment growth correspondent, Michael Roots, who's live from yet another orchard.
That's right, guys. The field outreach and education team reported earlier this year that the new CASP self-assessments over the last year were more than the 10 prior year totals combined. The number of orchards assessed under the supply chain program more than tripled last year, from around 300 to over 1,400. And acreage assessed under the program grew from just under 70,000 to over 150,000 acres. I caught up with a Modesto area grower, Scott Severson, earlier today, who talked about the benefits he has seen from the program.
What surprised me most about going through the CASP program was the ease of filling out the modules. Another surprise that I had of going through the CASP program was learning about areas where I can improve my approach to being more sustainable. I believe the greatest value of CASP is our ability to document our sustainability practices and tell the world.
The information from the CASP system is presented in aggregate form. Senior manager of the field outreach team, Tom Duvall, said that pooled information allows ABC to better tell the story of the almond industry and represent the grower in conversations. Live in another orchard, I'm Michael Roots.
This has been a good year for supplying new and better resources to help growers, from ABC's pest ID cards to its whole orchard recycling guide, and more. With up-to-the-minute details, we go to Senior New Growers Resources and Industry Publications correspondent Taylor Hillman, who is live at ABC offices.
He's not in an orchard?
No.
Well, that's right, guys. And although the industry communications team is often in the orchard helping develop these tools, most of their time is spent behind the scenes creating these resources. Translating the vast amount of grower-funded research into simple, actionable tools for growers is the goal for the industry communications team. I ran into Senior Manager of Industry Relations and Communications, Jenny Nicolau, who said her team has been busy over the last year.
I am so proud of the team's work this past year. We have made specific grower and PCA tools that they could keep in their truck that truly help with management decisions and help the bottom line. We've created everything from the whole orchard recycling guide to nitrogen and cover crop best management practices, and even irrigation resources. I have to say, my favorite ones are the new almond-specific pest ID and weed ID cards. I think what makes them even more impactful is we've put things together as a grower packet and a PCA packet, and that really ensures that we're bringing together what the industry needs and what they want.
Now, getting these tools into the hands of growers is just as important as developing the content. ABC created PCA packets that were sent to PCAs. They've also developed grower packets, which can be found down in the trade show at the ABC booth. ABC has also created a grower tools section at almonds.com under the Tools and Resources tab, where growers can search by topic and download these resources. Reporting live, not in an orchard, I'm Taylor Hillman for Almond Center.
Every year, the Almond Board of California is proud of the caliber of people who go through the Almond Leadership Program. And the industry is even more proud of what they all accomplish in their careers.
The Almond Leadership Program enrolls leading almond community members who go through the year-long program that introduces them to every aspect of the industry and prepares them to join a network of almond leaders. This class showed their character and through their perseverance because they had to work through the program for over 2 years due to limitations from the pandemic. We would like to congratulate them all, and you can learn more about each of them during the gala dinner on Thursday.
Just as importantly, we want to thank Bayer Crop Science, which sponsors the entire Almond Leadership Program. That demonstrates a huge commitment to our industry and our people. And now for a special presentation and something we look forward to every year, the Almond Achievement Awards. It is always a special moment for our industry.
This year is even more special because we have a new award, the Almond Technical Achievement Award.
The Almond Technical Achievement Award recognizes an industry or allied industry member who has added significant value to the California almond industry through research, innovation, or facilitated adoption of practices for the betterment of the industry. Joining me to help present this award is Dr. Karen Lapsley, ABC's recently retired Chief Scientific Officer, and Tim Birmingham, ABC Director of Quality Assurance and Industry Services. If they would please join me on stage. Good to see you, Karen. Good to see you, Tim. The candidate for this year's, or the recipient for this year's award has been recognized for his key role in establishing hundreds of processes that make almonds safer to eat. As the chairman of the Almond Board's Technical Expert Review Panel, lovingly termed TERP, for the past 17 years, he has been at the forefront of the industry's commitment to food safety. TERP is a third-party panel made up of experts in thermal processing, process validation, food safety, and microbiology. Tim Birmingham said, quote, he was instrumental in setting research priorities to identify risks associated with almonds and appropriate ways to control them, and he has led the TERP panel in ongoing program refinement and validation of more than 300 processes used on almonds, end quote. This award's first recipient is a microbiologist and longtime leader in the field of microbial food safety, who forged a career at the National Food Processors Association, later merging with Grocery Manufacturers Association, based in Dublin, California. In 2001, after the first of two salmonella scares associated with people eating raw almonds, he was asked by the Almond Board to help identify ways via pasteurization and other methods to ensure the safety of almonds. With his extensive experience in microbial food safety and thermal process validation, he was an excellent resource, integral in establishing strict protocols for evaluating processes used on almonds for microbial reduction. In 2004, after the second salmonella outbreak affected 29 people in 12 states, TERP was formed, with him as its first and only chairman until his retirement this month. Quote, the group consisted of 4 to 5 consultants who would work independently on sound science, said Guangwei Wang, the Almond Board's Associate Director of Food Research and Technology. Guangwei was instrumental in recruiting him to TERP. Wang said he was deeply involved in all the critical areas addressed by TERP, including the following: soliciting research proposals and evaluating project findings, establishing pasteurization criteria, developing validation guidelines for almond conventional thermal processes, for instance, oil roasting, blanching, PPO, and new pasteurization processes of raw almonds. Assessing validation reports of new pasteurization technologies submitted by process authorities, ensuring the validation guidelines closely followed by the process authorities as they carry out validation trials, communicating with regulators, et cetera. Guang Wei said, thanks to the independent gatekeeping of TERP on the validation of almond pasteurization processes, ABC has built credibility of our pasteurization program and earned confidence of the regulators who allow our industry to administer the pasteurization program. Birmingham and Wang both said the almond pasteurization program he helped create has not only solidified the almond industry's reputation for food safety, it also has become a model for other nut and low moisture food industries. So with that, ladies and gentlemen, please join me in congratulating the 2021 Almond Technical Achievement Award recipient, Dr. Ken Stevenson. Ken, will you come up, please? Come on over. It's good to see you. It's been a long time. How are you doing?
Okay.
Congratulations.
Thank you.
And thank you for so many years of service to this industry. It's kept us in a very safe place for a long time now.
It's been a great trip that we're on.
Yes, it has indeed. So would you care to say a few words?
As they have said, I'm retiring this month, and it's after a long and sometimes arduous journey that we've been on, getting started in trying to say what we could do to make sure that a salmonella problem didn't happen again. Thanks to work that Linda Harris had started, the Almond Board already had a lot of information, but we had to try and set up something that could be used to make sure that nothing like those salmonella outbreaks happened again. Richard has really provided some great guidance, and the ABC staff has really done a lot of work in this area too. So I guess I can just say that I'm proud to have been involved, and I hope things continue. So thank you.
Very good, thank you. Got a little photo op here.
Make sure we get a photo here.
Okay, we're going to take two. I need eyes right here. Okay, ready? One, two, three. One more time. One, two, three.
Thank you. Okay.
Great job, Ken.
Thank you, Ken. We'll see you later.
Swati, would you mind joining us on stage, please? The Almond Achievement Award has been presented each year since 2011. It goes to an industry and allied industry members whose added value to the California almond industry through long-term service, contributions, or innovations. This gentleman is a retired medical doctor in Fresno County who is also an almond grower. He has been deeply involved in the industry for more than 20 years, and as an ABC board member for 9 years and chairing the Nutrition Research Committee for 13 years. It is in that final role he established what may be become his primary almond-related legacy. Mike Mason said his contributions to the industry can be seen clearly in all almond health messaging around the world. He was part of the industry back when almonds and nuts were considered unhealthy. Through his leadership and subject matter expertise, he brought the almond science to life and helped almonds lose the stigma of being unhealthy and instead became known as a healthy food. Bill Moorcraft echoed the importance of his impact on how almonds are now perceived by consumers and others. His efforts have been directly supportive of changing the health perception of almonds from fatty and high in calories to the position almonds enjoy today, viewed as healthy, whole foods, and part of a good diet. This leader also has contributed in many other ways to the success of the almond industry. He has served on the Blue Diamond Board, supported multiple programs to mentor the next generation of industry leaders, and has been among the first to adopt forward-thinking farming practices in his own orchards. Kurt Wainanen, Director of Research and Development for Blue Diamond Growers, said his contributions to the industry have been enormous. Between growing almonds, leading a critical ABC committee, and serving as an Almond Board of Director, it's hard to imagine someone making a bigger impact on our industry. There is not a grower in the state whose prices have not benefited from the work he has guided and facilitated in the areas of nutrition research, added Christine Gimperly. Ladies and gentlemen, please join me in giving a huge congratulatory cheer for the 2021 recipient of the Almond Achievement Award, Dr. George Gushgarian, Sr.
Congratulations, George.
Congrats, George.
Thank you, Brian.
I'd like to say a few words.
Well, firstly, I'm overwhelmed by achieving this award, and I thank the Almond Board for awarding that to me. I've been, I don't know how many years here, multiple years, served on the board many years, but most of my enjoyment has come from serving on the Nutrition Research Committee. And that committee was first started in 1995 by Dr. Karen Lapsley. And I can say she was a good mentor to me as I came onto the committee. And after her retirement, her successor, Dr. Kalgonkar, has been a superb leader of the Nutrition Research Committee. So this award I really share with all the committee members that have served on the Nutrition Research Committee, share with Karen and with Swati both, and thank you very much.
Great job. Thank you so much.
Got a photo op here.
Get in next to Karen, I'll be on the outside.
Thank you, George. So, Brian, we almost done, or what?
Almost. We hope you've enjoyed today's State of the Industry address. It was fun to script and produce. However, we realize times are tough, very tough, maybe the toughest ever. I'm a grower. I'm going through this with you, just as the hundreds of growers who volunteer and serve at the ABC board and committees. There are so many chips stacked against us right now, sometimes it's hard to be positive. But you guys are resilient, and we will all get through. We are still in the pandemic, but we've had two successful COVID harvests. We've had price declines in the past year, and we've always recovered from a price decline. The success and viability of almonds hasn't changed, but the world has.
And speaking of the world, it just seems like we really are transitioning into a new world, not only here in California, but sort of everywhere. You know, the list is pretty long, but talking with so many growers, that Brian, you and I were talking earlier, he's putting in a new PVC system for one of his ranches, and between 1 month and the next, it went up by over $10,000 to do that. Just as one example of so many where the cost structure of our industry has been changing so quickly and not for the better. Obviously, the supply chain we talked about in the presentation, and it's been on everyone's mind for the last many months and will be for the next many months, I fear. But, you know, who thought we'd be in this kind of situation with such a strain on our ports and infrastructure, not enough drivers, chassis, you know, the whole system just being under such stress and cost increases. Obviously, the drought, don't need to talk about that probably, but gosh, it wasn't very long ago we were in a drought and we got out of it for a while, and it's just tough to be back in it again. And then, you know, COVID and how that's just affected business, it's affected all our lives, it's created, you know, divisiveness, it's created angst, I think, in many places, in many parts of our lives that certainly wasn't there before. We touched on Sigma, and it is coming down the pike. I think with the drought here, obviously, it's been elevated a little bit in terms of the timelines of implementation. But no doubt, progressively here, we're going to be talking about it more and feeling the effects of it. And just another thing that's sort of in this new world that we're transitioning into. I've been in the industry 19 years now. I've been through some tough times with you. We seem to come out of them pretty well. And then we have some good times for a while. And that's sort of been our legacy. And as Big Bryce reported earlier with the big board, we've had these amazing increases in production and seem to have found our way, both cost-wise as well as profitability-wise and certainly in terms of building new markets. So faith in the future, I'm optimistic. This time may be tougher than ever to sort of get that bounce back, but we've done it before, and I'm confident we'll do it again.
You know, they say when you're at rock bottom, there's nowhere to go but up. And I think the biggest concern for growers right now is, you know, from what I'm hearing, is it just me? Am I the only one that's struggling out there? You know, what are the neighbors doing? I mean, that's how we farm, right? You know, if your neighbor's running water on a Monday, guess what? I'm running water on a Monday afternoon. But it is invigorating to know that the 7,600 of you are with me, and we're all together in the same boat. And like Richard said, and like we've said, we've been through similar situations. There are cycles, but it's tough when it seems like there's so many factors just kind of knocking you down. So we've accomplished the amazing feats. And you know, when you look at it, we've had in the last 2 years a 37% increase in supply. And even though we're having fun during the state of the industry, Bryce on the big board over there, but you look at that, and we've crossed through 1 billion, 2 billion, and 3 billion pounds in a very short amount of time. So I'm optimistic for the future, and I'm optimistic betting on you guys in this industry.
One thing that I, you know, when we have tough times, it's you know, not forgetting what you've created and where you are as a person, as an industry, as a family. And I think that that's something that we should remind ourselves of, what we've created over these many years. We're the number one tree nut in the world by far. We're the number one ag crop in California. We're the number one U.S. specialty crop export. We're the number one U.S. agricultural export of anything to India by a long shot, our largest export market. We talked about new ingredients, new product development, far eclipsing all nuts for a long time. So the innovation that's gone on out there is something that you guys have brought on. Massive per capita increases in consumption in many countries, including this one. But again, Italy in the number one spot right now. And as I say in all of my interviews, when I get interviewed about the drought, I say California is the perfect place to grow almonds. If we're going to grow anything in the state, it should be this crop. 83-84% of the world's supply here, Australia in the single digits, Europe, mainly Spain and Portugal, single digits, 83% of the world's supply here. So as we look at the future of agriculture, and Jesse mentioned some of the challenges that are coming up, you know, what are we going to use the remaining irrigated land for? And in my opinion, almonds should be right at the top of the list. We mentioned the increases in production, and just once again, we've, as Bryce said, it took us 50 years to get to 1 billion pounds. It's taken us 20 years to get to 3. So fantastic performance. And we've been mostly profitable. That's why our industry has expanded the way it has. And I know that right now seems like a little bit distant, but we need to get back to profitable times. Maybe we're not going to expand as fast as we did in the past. Maybe we sort of plateau for a while and sort of figure out the Sigma thing and where irrigated land's going to go. But certainly we need to get back to a profitable industry.
Absolutely. You know, talking about community, it really all comes down to our families and our communities. And I just have to say what a celebration it is to be together in person at this conference. And going back to our August board meeting, it was a 50-50 chance if we were going to be here together. So very excited to see all of you again. It's been a couple of years. You know, we support each other, and we help build better lives together. When we're hurting, we console one another. When we're experiencing good times, we celebrate with one another generation after generation. And I just wanted to share, you know, some personal things. Sperry Farms was hit with a tragedy this year. My father-in-law and mentor, Jeff Sperry, passed away in May after a hard-fought battle with ALS. He was a fourth-generation farmer, and if he were here today, he would tell us to stay focused on the future, get through today. He would tell us to make sure to work hard, but to get your work-life balance right and cherish your friends and family. And finally, Jeff would tell us to make sure, above all, that we enjoy life.
Great man. Gonna miss him. So just to finish up here, I want to leave you with the vision for our industry, which is that California almonds make life better by what we grow and how we grow. And I think that that vision is rooted in the success of the industry, which is the theme of this conference. So with that, ladies and gentlemen, I think we should stand up.
I think so.
We'd like to thank you so much for attending today. We hope you enjoyed Almond Center and a bit of fun we had with that, but also the information we presented, sort of a tour around the globe of the different operations and different topics affecting the industry. As you know, the Almond Conference would not be possible without the generous support of the 270 record exhibitors this year and more than 40 sponsors. Special thanks goes out to recognize the 2021 medal sponsors, starting with our platinum sponsor, Yara North America.
Our gold sponsor is Burrell.
The silver is Tomra Food.
Emerald is Qcify.
Titanium, Bayer Crop Science.
Bronze, AC Horn Manufacturing.
Copper, Satake.
Nickel, PETA-G, Progressive Genetics.
Steel, Miller Chemical and Fertilizer.
Cobalt, the Ag Center. And I just wanted to say a special thanks to Darren Williams, Rick Cushman, Taylor Hillman, and Jenny Nicolau for putting on this amazing performance in a very short amount of time. And of course, a thank you to our board of directors for participating here, and obviously to all of you for being here in person, cheering us on, and talking about almonds.
And I'd like to thank my co-anchor, who did a very good job, by the way.
And thank you.
Keep that glow on. Keep that glow on. So the trade show is now open and is bigger than ever. As I mentioned, I encourage you to make time to visit the vendors and continue to help push our industry forward. I would also encourage you to check out the silent auction exhibit this year. There are new items every day. 100% of the proceeds go to scholarships for California FFA. And every dollar, listen up, every dollar up to $25,000 raised this year will be matched by our 2021 Emerald sponsor, Qcify. So Rafe Peters, thank you so much for your generosity in offering to do that. You can also purchase tickets for your chance to win a guitar signed by gala entertainer and up-and-coming country star Tyler Rich, so don't miss that one. And be sure to visit the Almond booth to sample Almond Brown Ale, created by two former Almond Leadership Program participants. Their beer is a gold medalist in the 2021 U.S. Open Beer Championships. I didn't even know those existed.
I didn't either. That's fantastic. And now come join us at the reception on the trade show floor, and a special thanks to Bayer Netafim for sponsoring this opening reception. And by the way, we do have rain on the forecast.
Thank you very much, ladies and gentlemen.
They say love is more precious than gold. It can't be bought and it can't be sold. I got love enough to spare that makes me a millionaire. I got a woman with eyes that shine. As a diamond mine.
my